After a national struggle sustained through many centuries, we have today in Ireland a native government deriving its authority solely from the Irish people and acknowledged by England and the other nations of the world. Through those centuries, through hopes and through disappointments, the Irish people have struggled to get rid of a foreign power which was preventing them from exercising their simple right to live and to govern themselves as they pleased, which tried to destroy our nationality, our institutions, which tried to abolish our customs and blot out our civilization. All that made us Irish, all that united us as a nation. But Irish nationality survived. It did not perish when native government was destroyed and a foreign military despotism was set up. And for this reason, that it was not made by the old native government, and it could not be destroyed by the foreign usurping government. It was the national spirit which created the old native government, and not the native government which created the national spirit. And nothing that the foreign government could do could destroy the national spirit. But though it survived, the soul of the nation drooped and weakened. Without the protection of a native government, we were exposed to the poison of foreign ways. The national character was infected and the life of the nation was endangered. We had armed risings and political agitation, but we were not strong enough to put out the foreign power until the national consciousness was fully reawakened. This was why the Gaelic movement and Sinn Féin were necessary for our last successful effort. Success came with the inspiration which the new national movement gave to our military and political effort. The Gaelic spirit, working through the Dáil and the army, was irresistible. In this light, we must look at the present situation. In any sane view, our military resources were terribly slender in the face of those of the British Empire, which had just emerged victorious from the World War. It was obvious what would have been involved in a renewal of armed conflict on a scale which we had never met before. It was obvious what we should have lost in strength if the support of the world which had hitherto been on our side had been alienated, if Ireland had rejected terms which most nations would have regarded as terms we could honourably accept. We had not an easy task. We were faced with a critical military situation over against an enemy of infinitely greater potential strength. We had to face the pride and prejudice of a powerful nation which had claimed for centuries to hold Ireland as a province. We had to face all the traditions and political experience and strength of the British nation. And on our flank, we had a section of our own people who had identified their outlook and interests with those of Britain. It may be claimed that we did not fail in our task. We got the substance of freedom, as has already been made real before our eyes by the withdrawal of the British power, and the people approved, and they were anxious to use the freedom secured. The national instinct was sound. That the essence of our struggle was to secure freedom, to order our own life, without attaching undue importance to the formulas under which that freedom would be expressed. The people knew that our government could and would be moulded by the nation itself according to its needs. The nation would make the government, not the government the nation. But on the return of Ireland's representatives from London, Mr. De Valera, who was then leader of the nation, condemned the treaty in a public statement, while supporting similar proposals for peace which he described as differing only by a shadow. But he and all the deputies joined in discussing and voting on the treaty, and after full discussion and expressions of opinion from all parts of the country, the treaty was approved.